And just in the meantime, while people join, so today what we're going to be building is a miniaturized version of our AR photo booth experience. And that uses some of Studio's core functionalities. So it uses one of the many tracking types that we support, so face tracking. But it's also worth noting we do support image tracking and world tracking, and you can actually build a mixed reality experience as well for Zapbox. So in this instance, in this project, we'll be using face tracking, and we're going to be building a experience where it probably looks quite familiar in terms of if you've played around with some other AR tools where you can play around with what's displayed on the user's face, whether that's sort of silly hats and stuff like that, and normally ones that are quite popular on social media. So this is our own sort of take on that, and it's just a quick version of how that would be implemented in Studio itself. And again, it's done all without any code whatsoever. It's just using, like we mentioned, face tracking, our controls and states functionality, and actions. So actions are our way of allowing you to add interactivity to your experience without necessarily having to write any code yourself. And as we go through this project, you will see how easy that is to set up and the time taken to actually build this. Most of it is actually just setting up content, positioning and stuff like that. But when it comes to setting the interaction for the end user, it takes no time at all. So since today, I'm just going to check if we have Anita on here. And I believe Anita is on the call with us. Hi. There we are. Hey, Anita.
Hi, Seb.
So just to give you a little introduction to Anita and myself, so I'm the head of technical support at Zappa, and this might be the boring bit if you've joined any of our previous webinars and you've seen me here, but I basically manage a team who create the learning content. The learning resources, that's tutorials, the articles you see, scripts and references and webinars and stuff like that. And then Anita, did you want to give everyone a brief introduction to yourself?
Yeah, so I'm the instructional designer in Seb's team, and I look at designing workshops and our training and tutorials.
Yeah. Awesome, yeah. And Anita is actually working on a really exciting tutorial, which if you do watch this webinar, then you've got a sneak announcement, I guess, before everyone else. But we're looking to get it out relatively soon. And I'm sure it's something that a lot of you will find super useful. And I mean, slightly biased on my end, but I do think it looks really cool.
Yeah. Feedback is always welcome. So let us know.
Apologies, I'm just having a slight sip of coffee. Cool. So, slightly jumped ahead of myself there. So we are going to be jumping into Studio now. If you bear with me. And we're using the asset pack that we've provided on the both on the webinar registration form, as well as the actual tutorial page on our website. And you'll notice that one, although the end experience has 3D models in it, there aren't any 3D models in that particular asset pack. Reason for that is we've actually provided what we call kind of like a starter project, which just basically allows you to get up to speed quicker with the experience without necessarily having to worry about the imports and kind of having to do that with, especially with the number of assets and media files that we're using in this one. That is something we do cover in our other documentation. We have a pretty comprehensive 3D model section on the doc site. So if that is something you are struggling with at all, then I'd recommend you check that out. And it's also worth shouting out the Sketchfab integration as well. So you can grab things using our Sketchfab integration. Cool. Any other bits and pieces you wanted to add to that little start project?
No, I think I was going to mention Sketchfab as well, but you beat me to it.
Nice, awesome. Too slow. Cool. So I guess we'll just kind of go through the project we have up on screen at the moment. So we have the media library here on the right. So this is where we have all of our 2D assets that we're going to be using throughout the project. And then just below that here, we have our symbol definitions. And it's just to rejig your memory. Any 3D models we import. Oh, sorry, go on.
So you said, yeah. I can't see your screen. I'm not sure if that's the same for everyone else.
Oh, I see.
Or not your studio screen.
Okay, let me.
Perfect.
How's that looking?
Yeah.
Nice. Apologies for that. So I'll just go back a few steps. So we were mentioning the media library here earlier, which is where our 2D assets are imported. So just our images in this case. And then below that, we have our symbol definitions. And what we were saying was when we import 3D models into Studio, they actually pop up here in your symbol definitions panel, just so that it can be reused throughout your experience. We won't go into too much depth on sub-symbols here, just so we're not kind of going over time on this, but that is something that we do cover on the site as well. So there's a really great way that Anita explains this kind of the UI of Studio, and it's where you have the content that you're using in the experience on the right, and the left side is where you actually control the appearance and add that to the current scene. So if you look at our scene at the moment, you see that there's nothing actually displayed in the viewport. And that's, again, because we don't actually have any of these images or 3D models on that left aligned hierarchy at the moment.
Yeah.
And then, if we actually take a look at the hierarchy on the left, we'll see we actually have a few groups set up. And there's a few benefits to using groups. And it's something I know that Anita and I have used quite heavily as well in our own projects. But essentially with groups, one, it allows you to kind of just manage your content a bit easier, especially when you're slightly more complex projects that are using, you know, a large amount of whether that's images or videos or audio files, for example. It's just nice to have everything organized and easy to navigate through. And the other major benefit of it is when you have groups, you can actually control the properties of all of the children of that group as if it were one object. So it just allows you to reposition things much easier than if you were trying to use all of that separately.
Yeah. I think he'll show us an example of that later. It's definitely one of those that helps to see.
Yeah, it's one of those workflow ones, I think, we tend to see where when you're first starting out, if you start with maybe slightly simpler projects, it's not something that becomes apparent until you start building more and more complex projects and you start finding it maybe slightly tricky to manage individual nodes, and then you realize that actually there's a trick I can use to just simplify that process.
I learned the hard way.
Not with this tutorial coming up.
No.
Cool. So what we're going to do is we're going to be building up parts of our UI in the first instance. So we're not going to be actually dragging our 3D models just yet from the symbol definitions. We're going to be using screen relative UI content. And because all of these are these groups sit within the root node by default is relative to the screen. So we don't actually need to change anything on that end. So in our main UI group, and I'll show you in a second why that's called the main UI, we're going to actually drag in two pieces of media files. So we have our hat options icon, which we're just going to drag from the media library into the main UI group. And you see that there. And one thing we can do, you'll see it's actually in, it looks like it's positioned the wrong way. But if we look at the viewport, we have the landscape option currently enabled. So we can quite easily just set that to portrait, which is the orientation that we want this experience to be viewed in. So you see it's actually the right way up. And once we have the icon in the viewport, you can very easily set its position. Whoops. Something is locked off here.
And so just to add to what Seb was saying earlier about the media library, I think a good way to explain the right side is that's where all your kind of assets for the project is managed. And then once you start dragging components over to the left side, your hierarchy, that's when you can start either managing its properties, that's when it becomes visible within the viewport, as you've seen, and so on.
Yeah. Sorry, just bear with me 1 second. That's three. There we go. Let's position that there. So I'm just seeing the transform tools here are just small at the moment, but we can still use the properties panel to move that content. So once you have the hat options in there, there's one more icon we want to add in here, and that is the snapshot icon, which is just going to do the exact same thing. So go ahead and drag that into the main UI group, and then that will appear there. And we can push this off to the side. So we'll set that to 3 in the x-axis in its transform property. And normally in the full tutorial, there is a third option, which is the glasses icon, glasses options icon. But for this webinar, we're going to keep it simple. And we're just going to be using these two. But if you do want to explore how the glasses were set up, then I do recommend checking out the full tutorial that's on the docs. Which we can leave a link to in the chat towards the end of the webinar.
I think, Seb, you mentioned this earlier, but it's just worth reinforcing that the reason why groups are useful is because you've already assigned the transform value to the groups so that the assets within it. But I think what you've just done reinforces that point, which is why they seem quite perfectly aligned.
Yeah, that's a trick we used on the tutorial. And like Anita was saying, we've basically, if we take a look at the main UI group, you see that the scale is already set to 0.2 in both X and Y. The Z value scale doesn't matter because it's their 2D icons, so they don't have a Z depth. But by setting the scale in those two axes, it means that anything we import from there will inherit that scale value. The reason they are perfectly uniform as well is because these two icons were actually created at the exact same resolution when they were being designed in a design software as well. So it's just worth reiterating that it doesn't mean that images with completely different resolutions are going to be imported at the exact same scale. So there's still a level of uniformity required on the production stage, I would say. Sorry. Cool. So we have our two main UI options set up, and the reason we say main UI options is this is what we want to be displayed when the experience is first launched, and then these two buttons are actually going to perform two slightly different functionalities. So the one on the right, you might have guessed it, with the camera icon, we're going to get to just take a snapshot, but we'll come to that slightly later on. This one on the left, however, we want to display a range of options for the user to play around with the hats that are currently being displayed and are going to be tracked to their face. So this icon on the left, this option, is going to activate a set of hat options. And so to do that, we're going to be working with the selection background group that we have here in the hierarchy. So we'll just collapse the main UI here for now. And this selection background is the one we're going to be working with. And in there are a number of images we want to add. So the first one is the selection background, which we'll drag in from the media library into that group. And you'll see that's quite small there. And we can increase the scale. So if I use, and I'm using X, C, and whoops, it's not there. I'm using X, C, and V in the viewport to set the transform tools that we're using. So X for scale, and C, I think C is rotation, and then V is for position. So equally, we can use these options at the top of the viewport just to do that. So I can drag that in there and position it like so. And next, what we want to do is we're going to be using this cancel icon image, which we're also going to drag into that group. And this we can position just like we did with the hat options. So we want that in the same position. We set that at -3 in the x-axis. Whoops, was it -3? That's my fault, sorry. Okay, so the other thing to mention is because these are different groups, they will have different coordinate systems. So whereas one value may be correct for one group, you do need to be careful with the other groups as well to make sure that content is positioned where it needs to be. So we'll set -2. And then that's being a bit picky here. But we can go, leave that there for the time being. One thing to note as well is the order of content in the hierarchy does matter. So we have two pieces of 2D content here at the moment. And you'll see that the icon that we just imported to that group is being rendered over the selection background. If we move that cancel icon node above the selection background, then you'll see that the background image is now rendered in front of it. So that's always one thing to keep in mind when you're building out your experiences is if there are any sort of visual glitches that you think, oh, that doesn't look quite right, just make sure that the ordering of content is correct. That is also something we do cover. We have an article in our docs called Render Order. So it's quite an interesting read just to see how content is rendered and then what the different properties can do to that render priority. So just going to go ahead and drag that back beneath the selection background group. And then within this selection background, we want to add in our actual option icons for each of the 3D models. So that's what we're going to go ahead and add here. So we'll just drag that sheriff hat icon. And instead of the selection background group, we're going to drag those into the hat options group. So like so. And we can position this sorry, just bear with me 1 second. We want this at 0, minus. Sorry, people, bear with me 2 seconds. These values don't seem to be quite right. And just hide that. So what I've done there is just I've hit the H button on the selection background group to hide the content. So again, that's one of those little keyboard shortcuts Studio does have. So again, there I was kind of struggling to find the transform widget for the sheriff icon that we just imported. So what I did was hit H on the selection background, and if you tap that, you can actually hide and show content. And it's worth mentioning that doesn't actually affect the visibility property of the node. This is purely a viewport only option. So it doesn't actually change the behavior of your experience. Let's see what's... Okay, I see the option here, the icon here, but it seems to be slightly glitched out. So apologies, bear with me 1 second.
And I think also, so whilst you do that, so I was just going to say, I think when it comes to the studio, we all have different workflows. So it really is up to you and what works best. So the way I'm kind of seeing what Seb is doing at the moment, and this is something that I tend to do, I don't know whether he goes off in a different direction, but is I tend to assemble my scene. So this is kind of like assigning how my project will look before I go on to the second part, which is maybe setting up what happens within it.
Yeah. There's a number of different workflows you can take. And it's not normally a case of right or wrong one. It's mm-hmm. what you kind of feel comfortable with. I know one thing that we sometimes differ on is one that comes up in discussion quite a lot actually is when do you create the project, for example, on a Zap website? And really that it doesn't matter too much whether you create it before you start working in studio or after, for example, just as long as it's done before you're going to publish to that particular project. But that's just one example of times where the exact workflow doesn't necessarily matter. There's just whichever method you feel comfortable with and whichever one you feel you're more efficient with as well, obviously. Cool. So I've dragged in a new version of that icon. I think there was a slight issue there with the original one. It may be an issue with the group itself, potentially with its scale. So I'm placing the hat icon outside of that group for the time being. But again, it won't actually affect the functionality itself. So I'm going to hit H again on the selection background, just so we can see that again. And then we'll take the sheriff hat icon and we'll scale that down slightly. And then again, using the V keyboard shortcut, we can activate the property transform widget. So we're going to do the same thing with the other hat options. So we have a pirate hat icon in here. Drag in there underneath the sheriff hat. And one thing you can actually do, again, this is another little workflow tip, is we've already scaled the sheriff hat and we don't want to have to sort of guess exactly which number that's at. Sometimes you may have those values exactly. In our instance, what we can do is go to the sheriff hat icon, go to the properties panel and find that scale value. And we can just right click that and hit copy value. Then when we come back to the pirate hat, we'll go to the scale property and right click and hit paste value. And that's now the exact same scale as our previous icon. And we can, I mean, saying that, we will just position by site here. So we're not going to be too exact on that one. But you can actually copy and paste the value of multiple properties in the properties panel. So that's not just confined to the position or the transform properties. So let's go ahead and drag in the other one. So the baseball icon, we're dragging in there. And again, once we've dragged that in, we'll head on over to the properties panel and right click, paste that value into the scale, and then just drag that roughly around there. And the last one, the last hat option, which is the halo, do the exact same thing there. So go to the properties panel, right click scale and paste the value, drag that into there. And we're going to push these up slightly just to make room for a fifth option we're going to have. And this fifth option is the ability to reset. So by reset, we mean we have icons to activate those four hats, but we also want an icon that removes them in case the end user wants to take it off. In the full tutorial, there are also glasses options, so it just allows them to kind of play around with those with different combinations. So that's again just more of a sort of end user consideration when you're building these experiences, is try and account for every possibility, because you never know how people are going to end up interacting with your experience. So that's actually one which, when I was initially concepting the tutorial with the team, it's one that hadn't come up in the first instance. And then while we were testing, and it's one of the reasons why we always encourage testing as you're building, is it, we played around with it and then we realized, well, actually, we've added the option of the hats, but if someone wanted to just have, let's say, the glasses on or whatever, we hadn't actually built that option into it. So then it was an easy case of just adding an additional option, editing a few values, and you're basically done. And all of that was obviously sped up through the use of Studio's controls and states and actions, which meant it was a matter of minutes to add that functionality in there. So just going to go ahead and paste that value again in for that and drag that in to the last bit there. And apologies, I do realize the this content isn't quite aligned, but we're kind of just going off of this by sight. But don't worry, in the full tutorial, you will find full values for this content.
I thought it was more aligned before, but...
Yeah, I'm looking at the background at the moment, and we can actually change that. And this is again, a perfect opportunity and was not scripted in any way whatsoever. To show you how those groups can help. So obviously, as Anita pointed out, the background of it is actually it's not quite aligned, but because we used a group for the selection background, you can actually move that entire group at the same time. So we can do that, and it's slightly more aligned with the content, meaning we're moving this icon here at the bottom, the cancel icon, and the selection background at the exact same time. So, like so.
Yeah.
There we are. It's looking better.
It is.
Cool. So those are the options set up. But one thing we may have noticed is that we actually have those hat options displayed on top of the previous main menu options. And the camera option is actually still displayed there. And the reason that is we haven't actually set up functionality to hide them appropriately whenever one or the other is activated. And to do that, we're actually going to use states. So states are a really easy way of kind of defining the behavior of your content. And I'll show you what that basically looks like in this particular project. But it's worth noting that the way we're going to show you isn't at all an exhaustive method of using states. It actually has a whole bunch of different use cases. And if you've had a chance to look through our tutorial content, you'll realize that pretty much all of our tutorials will use states or controllers in one way or another, but they have very, very different outcomes based on how we're playing around with them. Mm-hmm. And it's worth mentioning, like, I think states play quite a big part as well in your up and coming tutorial, right, Nisa?
They do, yeah. It's a big part.
Cool. So let's create a new state. Before you create a state, you actually have to create a new controller. So we're going to create that and say this is called active menu, for example. So that's our controller. And to a controller, you can either add states or timelines or both as well if you'd want to. Just by right-clicking, putting new state, and we'll call this main menu. Like so. And in this main menu, there are a few properties that we want this controller to manage. And those properties are essentially the visibility and the enable properties for these content. So what that basically means is we want some of them to be visible when the others are not shown, and we want the others to be hidden when these are shown. Slightly confusing there, but it will make more sense when we show this in the viewport itself. So what we can do is go ahead and select the selection background, and you'll see that the properties panel now has a number of plus icons on the right of each property. Clicking on those plus icons will add them to our current controller, and it means it can now be managed by that controller. So what we want is the visibility property for the selection background and the enabled property for the selection background. And we also want that those same two options for the main UI group. So if we just collapse that and select main UI, we can tick visibility and, add the plus icon to visible and enabled. And as we do that, you'll see that these options start being displayed here in the states state view at the bottom of the UI. And what this does is essentially just list out which nodes have been added to this controller and which particular properties have been added to this controller. So usually, and in the full tutorial, we actually do just add the hat options group visibility and enabled, but because of that slight issue, we will just run through and add those two properties for each of the actual icons themselves. So we'll add the enabled and visible properties for those pieces of content. So just going to run through quickly in the properties panel and the hierarchy. So you notice we're flicking between the properties panel and the hierarchy in this instance. And actually what we can do while we're doing that is when we're finished adding all of these properties, and we could have done this as well as we were going through, but it's what we're going to do is edit all of these properties once we're done. We're going to have multiple states, and in each of those states, these values will be changed. So res icon, I believe we've added there. So the state we currently have selected is main menu. And in the main menu, we don't actually want the options to be displayed. So now that we've added those properties, it's a simple case of going through and unticking these. So again, slightly longer steps just because we haven't used the group there on the hat options. Otherwise, it would be a simple case of doing one node essentially for all of these icons. So we're just going to run through those quickly and untick visible and enable for these. just really quickly, final icon, and then same thing for the selection background here. So by doing that, you'll see that we now have the main menu displayed, much like we did at the very beginning of the webinar when we just imported those two pieces of content. And conversely, well, the other thing we want is for the actual selection to be displayed and hide these two pieces of UI. So to do that, we'll basically do the opposite. And we're going to create a new state within the controller we already have, and we'll call this hat options. And within the hat options script, you see that this jumps back up here. Reason being, it's inheriting the values that were set on the properties when they were first added to the controller. So it does mean we don't actually have to run through each of those hat icons again. Instead, we just need to go to the main UI and untick the visible and enable properties on that. And then if we flick through those two, you'll see we have the main menu and the hat options up. So they're no longer interfering with each other. That's our UI setup. And the next parts actually are pretty quick to do. So the next thing we're doing is actually setting up our 3D models in the scene. Then we'll be creating states for each of those 3D models so that they're visible. And then lastly, we'll be setting up actions. And just to show you how easy it is to use face tracking functionality in Studio, all we need to do is select back on the base controller. So going back to the base controller just means you're able to edit property whenever you want, essentially, without being confined to that particular controller. If we were still in the active menu controller, you'd notice that we are unable to edit the position or scale, rotation, etc. For these nodes. So we just remember always click back on the base controller when you're done playing around with states and timelines. So we'll click the roots node because we want to add a new node here. So right click, go new, and it's under the trackings option. You'll see face group. And face paint is another face tracking option we have. We won't be using in this particular webinar, but essentially what face paint does just allows you to overlay some paint on the user's face. I know that sounds pretty much just repeating its name, but it is really that simple. It gives you a face on the UI, and you can update the a single property, so just which image you want to overlay, and then it, boom, it's projected onto their face, and it's that simple. And
I was just going to add, it's almost a filter type effect, depending on what you create.
Yeah, that's 100% true. And in fact, yeah, that is probably how most people will recognize it. If you've seen these face filters on social media and stuff like that, that's the way to build that type of content in Studio. But face group, the face group node is just as easy to kind of work with. So we're just going to head and add one of those to our root. And you'll see this face pops up in our viewport. And this is a guide for us to use for positioning our content. And just allows us to position content in 3D space around the user's face. But it's worth noting that it doesn't mean it's confined to 3D content. You can actually place 2D content around the user's face as well.
But would you say that that's the distinction then between face paint and face group?
Yeah, so with face group, you can position stuff around their face, but face paint allows you to project things onto their face directly. So you'll get that face deformation as well if they open their mouth and stuff like that. But yeah, it's a distinction of things being projected on their face versus positioned around them in 3D space.
That's good.
Cool. So because we're using objects, 3D objects that will be partly positioned behind the user's head, one thing we want to do is mask out areas of the user's head so that it doesn't look like the entire thing is floating in front of them, which is an effect you'd get otherwise. There's a little example of that in our face tracking documentation in case you wanted to check that out. But what we need to know for this case is we're going to add a new symbol definition from the plus icon. And it's one of the first ones you see here, the head mask. So we can just add that to the project. Okay. And using the head mask is a simple case of just dragging that into, and specifically we'll be using the origin group from the face group. So you see that there are a number of groups here exposed from when we first used, first added the face group. And all those allow you to do is, you know, set different origin points for the content in case you need to fine tune their position. For this instance, we can just use the origin, and that's absolutely fine. And then what we can do is add the hats to this group. So we'll be adding the halo.
And would I be correct in saying, so please correct me, that it's kind of almost interchangeable. You could use origin points. That's what we use in Studio. That's the term. But you could consider it as an anchor point if you're new to Studio until you get to grips. Is that correct? Or
yeah, that's correct. So the other way to think of it is as the point that that content will be anchored to. The origin kind of comes from also the coordinate system, I guess, of where that the origin point is defined based on that specific location on the user's face. But it is also easy to think of as the anchor point for that content. So yeah, good shout. So we have our halo here, and we're just going to go ahead and add these. We're going to kind of pop these on top of each other. So we will see some overlap there in the content, but we'll fix that in no time once we start working with our states again. And one thing we've noticed here already is this pirate hat looks very dark, and it doesn't quite look like what we have on the tutorial. And the reason for that is...
I know this one.
Oh, sorry. Take it.
No, maybe I don't.
Take it away.
Lighting?
Exactly. Yeah, it's exactly that. So good spot. Yeah, we basically have these 3D models, and some of them have been set up with lighting materials, which, like Anita mentioned, it basically means that these models react to lighting in the scene. If you don't have a light in the scene, then it's as if they're in a dark room, so nothing's going to be no color's going to be rendered on them, essentially. So again, we just head back to these simple definitions, head on over to the lighting panel, and we can add a gravity light, which is essentially just a preset lighting option that we already have in there, but you can set up fully custom light setups within Studio. So just drag that into the origin group as well, and there we are. You see that looks much nicer. So let's drag in our baseball cap, and we can scale this up if we wanted to. We actually do need to scale it up slightly. We'll leave it facing backwards because, you know, cool. pop that there. Again, this is, they're all being displayed at the same time, but that's something that we're going to remedy with our states. So I believe the final one is the sheriff hat, if I'm not mistaken, which we'll be dragging into the group as well. And again, just using the tools on the keyboard, so X, C, and V to update the transform properties. And that just makes it slightly easier to work with without having to go to the properties panel. So obviously at the moment, this looks quite bad. We don't really want all of those displayed when a user scans. So we're going to be using states again in order to manage those. So if we go in and hit new controller, and we can call this something else like active hat, for example. And what we're going to do with these is right click and add a state. And we're actually going to be adding a state for each of the hats. But the first state that we're going to create is going to be called none. The reason we're making that one first is the first state you add to a controller is the default state, which means it's what's going to be active whenever your experience is first scanned. And while you can change default state, it just kind of makes it easier for workflow again if you know which one you want to be active in the first instance. So we're creating that now. So now that we have none state, what we want to do is add the visible and enable properties for each of these 3D objects. So the halo, we'll add the visible and enable properties. And these we can untick as we go along. in this active state. So you'll see that they start disappearing from our viewport. So we're just going through with pirate hat and doing the same thing. So we're adding the visible and enable properties and then unticking those. And we'll do that with the baseball cap as well. And then lastly, the sheriff hat. And then you'll see that we're back to square one with our viewport. There's nothing in there. And that is exactly what we want to happen with our active hat none state. We don't want anything to show, but we do want to create new states for each of those. So if we set halo, the first instance, in the halo, you see, again, they're all displayed because it's inheriting the values of those properties when they were first added to the controller. So we're going to go through, and instead of making all of them invisible and disabled, we'll do them to all except for halo, so that it's still in the scene. So just running through the hierarchy and going to the properties panel and then hiding the ones that aren't the halo. There we are. So now we have one state with nothing displayed and one state with the halo. So we're just going to run through and do that quickly with the rest of them. So pirate, and we select that state, and then go through and just make sure anything that isn't the pirate hat is disabled and invisible.
Right, and that's kind of what I use. I kind of use this repetitive sentence when I'm setting things up. Like, when this is visible, then all of these nodes must be hidden. And it's just kind of a pattern that I use to go through. But otherwise, yeah go ahead.
No, I was gonna say that's something I tend to do as well, is just when you, again, just if you verbalize things, it helps to kind of better understand what's happening. And there's plenty of times where I may have been working on a project and I can't quite figure out what's going wrong or why this particular thing might not be working. And it's always when you start talking aloud to yourself and saying, right, I want this thing to activate this and I want this to do that. And then it kind of lets you follow the flow of logic that you're working on. And then inevitably you'll find out, oh, okay, I'm doing X thing wrong. Therefore, that's why this is happening. So it's, again, just another really helpful kind of workflow tip there.
But of course, naming properly helps so much, especially when you have so many, assets in your hierarchy.
Yeah, naming is one of those where it may not seem that important at first until you start working with kind of versioning of different assets and stuff. And especially when you, like you mentioned, if you have a large number of content in your hierarchy. So we've got the controller set up, and if we run through those states at the moment, you'll see we have the halo, pyre, we have a number of states, and what we've done is essentially hide everything except that particular hat at that instance. And again, that didn't take us too long to do with states. Now there's a couple of things we want to do. So now we want to actually add the interaction to our project. And for that, we're going to be using actions. And I believe we use, again, heavily promoting your tutorial here that's coming up, Anita, but I believe actions make a star appearance in your tutorial, if I'm not mistaken.
They certainly do, yes.
Yeah, I think so. Actions are just great because they seem, you'd expect that there's a lot more to it in order to create this interaction in your experience, but when you actually start using actions, you realize that, well, actually no, it's just really straightforward. There's a few button clicks and you're off, basically. And we'll show you that in practice now, actually. So now we actually have the UI option set up. So what we want to do is, in our main UI, we want this hat options icon that we have there. And one thing, again, like I mentioned earlier, it's always important to make sure you have the base controller selected before you start editing. And in fact, you can't add actions unless the base controller is selected.
Yeah.
So we'll head back, making sure base is selected, and then go to the main UI and find the hat options icon. And if we go to the top of the properties panel.
Could you show like a quick example of what happens when the base controller isn't selected?
Yeah.
I think that's the mistake I first made.
Of course. So if we go to active menu, you'll see, if you try to add an action, you'll see a message here saying that you can't be edited within a controller. And equally, if we did try and edit any of these properties, you see we're unable to because they haven't been added to this particular controller. So to do that, to fix that, we just head back to base, and now we're back in almost editing mode, essentially, for the rest of the project. So back at the top of the properties panel for the hat options, we just want to go add on tap, just when the user taps it, and we actually want to activate the state. So for this one, In the first dropdown, you select the controller, in this instance, the active menu, and the first thing is the how options. So what we've done there is we've said when this icon here is tapped, activate this bit. So pretty straightforward. And if we go back to the base, for the snapshot icon, we're also going to be adding an action, but instead of activating a state, what we're actually going to do is use the take snapshot. So again, it's just really easy to add interaction to your experience, and that will use our built-in functionality that lets users take a quick snapshot of whatever's on their screen, in this instance, their face.
And the sheriff hat.
And the sheriff hat, exactly. So then next thing we have is the selection background, and this might be one that's easy to overlook, but if we look back on the hat options icon, there's the cancel icon there. What we want that to do is take us back to the main menu. So we're also adding an action to this UI node. So we'll just go actions, on tap, and activate states. Again, in the first dropdown, we'll choose active menu. And the second dropdown, we'll choose main menu. So that takes us back to that main UI bit. And next we have the options. So these icons themselves that we're showing at the moment, we want to add actions to those so that they activate the state in which each of those 3D models is displayed. So very easily, we'll just run through that, and sheriff hat, we want to activate the hat options, active hat, sheriff state. So what that's going to do is display this. Then with the pirate hat, we'll do the exact same thing. Just run on tap. Activate a state, active hat, and then set the pirate. And then again, the reason I'm speeding through this is because it's the exact same simple process to do for each of this content. So there's no need to kind of linger on that too much, because it takes longer to kind of speak about it than kind of just do it yourself. It's really that simple. And then lastly, we have the halo icon, which will again add the active hat and the halo state. So the last one being the reset icon. And this is the reason why we set up that none state in the beginning as well. So aside from it being the state that's going to be active when it's first launched, it's also the state that's going to be activated when the reset icon is tapped. So we'll go actions, on tap, activate state, and then active hat, controller, and none. So that is the interaction side of the project setup. So we now have a number of states. So if we were to preview this, you can select these options and play around with that. However, one thing to note is if we were to preview this at the moment, you would still see the normal camera feed. You'd be seeing what's in front of you. And the reason for that is we haven't activated the front-facing camera. So in Studio, it's a very, very easy way to do that. While you can set up custom sort of camera in behavior, I guess. So you could set this up if you wanted to when a user taps a specific button, for example. So that would work if you have a face tracking portion of the experience, but you want it to launch into a regular view in the first instance. But what we want to do is immediately set that to view the front facing camera, because it's a fully face track experience from the get go, basically. And the easy way to do that is heading over to our root node, because our root node also has actions. So what we have here is, again, we have on show and on hide. So we don't get the on tap option that we got previously, just because it's worth mentioning those actions are context sensitive to the node that they're being added to. So you won't get an on tap action on the root, for example, because it's not an actual tappable object. But what we can do is on show, which means when this root, the parent symbol, is first shown, we want to do is use the front-facing camera. And that's it. So that's how easy that was to change it from a rear-facing camera to a fully front-facing face-tracked experience. And that is basically it. That is our AR photo booth project built. Again, no code necessary for any of that. Really simple to set up the user interaction on that end. And yeah, I mean, there's the tutorial does go into a little bit more depth. It adds a third option here, which lets the user play around with the glasses that are being displayed. But it uses the exact same process we've used for this project. So we just have a bunch of icons with actions assigned and some states in which those 3D models are displayed or hidden, respectively.
I think that's it. Like, once you learn the basic functionality for even setting up a menu, this can be used in so many other ways. In fact, like, this actual menu could be used in another project, and you could maybe swap out the icons, but the interactivity would still be there.
Yeah, that's correct. That's it's another part of one of the great things about working with Studio is that ability to kind of reuse projects and create your own templates with them. So for example, like Anita was saying, we could essentially import new media files and replace the images that are being used here, and without having to drag everything in again and reposition if we wanted to. For example, if I use this cancel icon as an example, again making sure base is selected, if we head down to the material, you'll see that it's using cancel icon.png as its material. If we were to import a new image, so in this case, let's go ahead and change it to aviators. You see that swapped out in the viewport. It's keeping the same scale, the same resolution, the same position. The only thing it's updating is which image is being used as its material. So doing so just allows you to create your own templates. And again, we've changed that icon, but as Anita was saying, the functionality is still there. So that icon will still activate the main menu active state. So it does allow you to kind of play around with what's being displayed in those states and the look and feel of those buttons while having the core functionality set up a single time. You're basically away with that.
Right. So if you're a company, for example, you could brand that once and then use it across other projects that you build and spend time on those aspects instead of the interactions such as menus and so on that should be consistent.
Yeah, that's correct. Cool. So I think there aren't any questions in the chat, if I'm mistaken, Anita?
No.
Cool.
Questions?
Nice. I think we'll wrap that up slightly early then. But again, I'd encourage everyone to head on over to the docs site and check out the AR photo booth tutorial that we have there. Again, it's worth noting we do have a number of tutorials. So there's some for world tracking, which George, who is also on the learning support team, who he created. It's a really cool world tracking interior design, and we'll also have some more content on there very, very soon from Anita. But yeah, go ahead and test that out. If any of you do play around with it and manage to get your own 3D assets in there or create your own funky AR photo booths, we'd love to see that. So
definitely,
yeah, check that on the forum. We do have a really cool community on there that are always looking for new projects, whether it's to help out newcomers or people who've been with us for a while, kind of sharing the project that they're creating to kind of push our tools to higher levels, essentially.
And we're open to ideas as well.
Oh yeah, 100%. We love seeing what everyone's working on, and even the interesting kind of dilemmas that people run into as well. Always, it either helps us to kind of a lot of times it will inform us on what we can cover in future resources and tutorials and articles and that sort of thing. So yeah, always open to feedback, always open to suggestions from everyone. So yeah, hopefully we'll see you soon on the forum. Or again, if you want to contact support, we are here as well. And we'll pop the tutorial link, I think, on the forum site potentially. But for any of you, it's just the tutorial section on docs.zap.works. Really simple to find. Cool. All right. Well, thank you for watching, everyone. We will speak to you again soon. And hopefully we'll see you next week for our YouTube Q&A session.
See you.
All right. Take care, everyone.